Hi, this is Ed Fries for RingScoops, and this is your NXT review for May 3rd, 2022. NXT started off hot and heavy this week with Cameron Grimes defeating Solo Sikoa and Carmelo Hayes in what I thought was the best match of the night. This match was incredibly good. These guys just tore it up. NXT has this great way of going ahead and telling a triple threat match in the non-WWE style where it's two guys battle and one guy rolls to the outside and then one guy comes in and one guy rolls out. Even the times where Carmelo Hayes was on the outside, it wasn't the typical chicken heel being stuck on the outside and waiting and biding his time. He kept trying to get back in the ring and got knocked back down every time. For three or four times, it was really interesting and well done. They even had a Tower of Doom spot in this match, all kinds of stuff. I got really caught up when I thought Solo Sikoa was going to win this match after Solo Sikoa hit the Uso splash off the top rope, and he got a 2 5/8 count as Carmelo Hayes just got in there to get the to break up the pinfall before the referee hit for three. The crowd was chanting that was three. Mello thought it might have been three. The announcers thought it might have been three. That was really good. I really bought into that near fall. I thought that was going to be the end. The end comes really soon afterwards when Solo Sikoa has Carmelo Hayes up for a Samoan drop, and Cameron Grimes goes ahead and hits a top rope cave-in on his head for the victory. Carmelo Hayes retains that North American Championship match, and I'm excited to see what goes on from here, because I think you put Carmelo Hayes and Solo Sikoa into a feud with each other, or you move Carmelo Hayes up to the main event spot, and somebody else is going to have to come in and fill that spot for Cameron Grimes. Maybe somebody like Zion Quinn. Maybe somebody with the, you know, bringing in the Viking Raiders. Maybe somebody comes down from Raw or SmackDown to be able to do it. We had Wendy Chu out here ruining Mandy's tan at the tanning salon as she goes ahead and messes with it. And Mandy Rose comes out all kinds of red. They keep referring to her like a strawberry. Mandy Rose may have been the most beautiful strawberry if that was the case. But Toxic Attraction says that she shouldn't go to the beach like that. And Mandy Rose wants to go somewhere inside to go ahead and celebrate with her girls as they relax, not being on the card tonight. But JC Jane and Gigi Dolan say, no, we're still going to go to the beach like we wanted to. You go ahead and hang out by yourself. We then had Nathan Frazer being interviewed by Mackenzie Mitchell backstage before Grayson Waller comes to the ring. Nathan Frazer makes me feel old because this guy is a graduate of the Seth Rollins Black and Brave Academy. And to think that somebody's a graduate from that school and is already on television in NXT is an incredibly quick ascent to the top. So it's very fun to see this. He's very, very happy to be here. He says it's been his lifelong dream. He's been waiting for this moment for 10 or 11 years. Really, really good. Grayson Waller comes to the ring. We go to commercial break. When we come back, Diamond Mine is backstage getting ready for their match. You have Ivy Nile in the back just prepping up on the board. But Roderick Strong's being a dick, just being an absolute dickhead, saying that he's the leader of the Diamond Mine. And the Creeds are like, okay, cool. You know, we're going to win tonight. And he's like, yeah, no. Come on, focus on me. Don't go back to training. Focus on me. And it seemed like it was spelling doom and disaster for them tonight. But we'll get back to that in a little while. We then had Indy Hartwell backstage with Duke Hudson. And it looks like they're coming together. But they quickly, Indy says no. And Duke Hudson realizes it was a bad idea. And they both walk away. But it seems like, as Persia said, the body's not even cold yet, dude. Fun little spot. I'm interested to see where it goes, but I really hope it doesn't end up with these two as a couple after the releases of both Persia Parada and Dexter Lumis. Nathan Frazer then came out and he did defeat Grayson Waller. Mark from the challenge was there as well in the crowd as well as Andre Chase. Andre Chase and Bodie were in there as Chase University, and Chase University's air horn lets Nathan Frazer get the advantage when Grayson Waller falls off the top rope, hangs himself on the top rope, and Nathan Frazer hits the Phoenix Splash for the victory. We then had the announcement of Fallon Henley, who's going to be in the breakout tournament. Very excited for this. Gives us a little bit of backstory about the before she was the bartender and hanging out with Jensen and Briggs. She goes ahead and she liked to ride horses. So we get that whole story, and she talks about how she's going to ride the horse with the NXT Women's Championship contract after she wins the tournament. We then had Legado del Fantasma and Tony D'Angelo arriving for the sit-down. I thought they were arriving at the arena. Fun to know that they were arriving at a restaurant because it was going to be a cinematic thing. We get a backstage segment with Bron Breakker getting ready for his championship title match tonight. Again, so far, the best thing on the show has obviously been the match that opened the show. But we're getting a lot of storyline development here with a lot of stories being told, even with amongst the releases. So it's good to see that they're continuing telling these stories. Santos Escobar and Tony D'Angelo had an absolutely amazing segment out here with the families getting together. We had AJ Galante along with Tony with Two Dimes and Stacks out there on Tony D'Angelo's side, as we had all of Legado del Fantasma, including Electra Lopez, there for Santos Escobar. I didn't even take a whole lot of notes on this segment because the dialogue was just interesting, as both guys are looking to become, you know, the leader of this and not give an inch. But they eventually go ahead and agree that peace is better for both parties than war, because war is just going to lead to more and more problems with the two of them. Really fun segment. Really got into it. Really enjoyed this segment. The Viking Raiders are backstage talking about up the Creeds and how excited they are to wrestle them. And then Pretty Deadly comes in, and I was like, ooh, this could be fun. Pretty Deadly interrupts and says that the Creeds are damaged goods and that they're the ones who damaged them. And the Viking Raiders should say thank you. And the Viking Raiders say, well, maybe after we get done with the Creeds, we'll show you guys who are damaged goods. And maybe we'll damage the goods. And Pretty Deadly quickly walks away. I thought this was going to be setting up Pretty Deadly versus the Viking Raiders. And that was going to be really, really interesting to me. We have Joe Gacy coming in and talking about change and how NXT is about to see a change and how they go through change. I like this because it's kind of a meta commentary on the releases and the name changes and things like that. Talking how about this constant change in this world and everything that goes on, but that he's ready to make a change for NXT. And if they're not ready for it and he may not win, you're not going to like what comes next. And I really, really enjoyed that from Joe Gacy. Just truly inhabiting this villain, horror movie villain thing. It's really, really doing so much better than all the other stuff he was doing before. We then had Nikita Lyons and Cora Jade defeating Natalya and Lash Legend. Match was better than I expected, but it still wasn't super great. There was a lot of good in this match. There was a lot of, you know, rough spots. Lash Legend is getting better, but she still needs a lot of work. Her kicks aren't nearly where they need to be. Nikita Lyons is looking better and better every week. Cora Jade is getting really, really well, and I think that working with Natalya is only going to make her better. That being said, it feels like Natalya working down to her talent in this match as opposed to trying to bring them up to her level. Natalya felt like she might have been working a little slower, trying to make sure that she didn't outshine all the other talent. Really great spot in here where Nikita Lyons rolls up Lash Legend a little bit when it wasn't expected, and Lash Legend gets kicked by Natalya, which leads to Lash Legend staring down Natalya, which leads to Natalya getting thrown out, which leads to Nikita Lyons getting the upper hand and then tagging in Cora Jade for the pin. Not really sure why Cora Jade needed to get the pin over Lash Legend here, as opposed to just letting Nikita get the pin, because she did the split that she normally pins with before tagging out, but it is what it is. We then got Tatum Paxley being announced for the breakout tournament. Interesting to see that this week, a lot of the talent being announced for the breakout tournament are talent that we've already seen on TV. This is the second one. We have two more coming that are really, really interesting names that I didn't expect to see in this tournament. This women's breakout tournament is going to be fantastic. Last week, we praised NXT for going ahead and having so many women on the show. This week, we have to take a little bit of a look at that. We had one women's match. We had a women's story, which continued throughout the show, which is promising considering it featured five different women in that storyline. We had Indy Hartwell briefly on camera tonight, and we had multiple people going ahead and being pushed forward for the women's breakout tournament. But one women's match on a card this big felt a little bit like a step backwards, not quite the NXT that we're used to, but at least there are women being featured. And next week we are going to get the start of the women's breakout tournament. So we're going to see at least two matches from that. We have another match that's going to be announced in just a little bit. So that's going to be at least probably three women's matches on next week's card. Back to the normal ebb and flow of NXT next week. But this week, while we praised them last week, we have to go ahead and talk to about them, about saying maybe they could have done a little bit better. After that, we had Gigi and JC being stalked by Roxy and Wendy Chu at the beach. As they get to the beach, they go down to the water, and Roxy and Wendy Chu go ahead and steal their shoes and their car keys. When Toxic Attraction comes back, they can't find their car keys, they can't find their shoes, and they see that Wendy Chu is out there and she's dangling the car keys, and Roxanne is with her, and they go ahead and have to do a chase, but of course barefoot in hot sand in Florida. And then they move the car halfway down the block, and you can see where the car is, but now the girls have to walk on the hot cement again. There's room for this kind of funny storytelling because this isn't super compelling and it's kind of storytelling as well. But there's room for funny stuff like this with Wendy Chu and all the stuff that she does with Toxic Attraction that you wouldn't find on a lot of other things, because you do so much other serious storytelling with the Joe Gacy and the Bron Breakker stuff, with the great wrestling stuff that you saw in the opening segment. It leaves room for stuff like this. Wrestling gets to be silly and stupid and fun at times too, and you shouldn't just hate on something like that just because it's not serious and, you know, I want to be serious for a moment, Lance Storm kind of stuff. It's allowed to be fun and silly. So, you know, go ahead and laugh. The interesting thing that we found about this is that Roxy is saying she doesn't know if she should be doing stuff like this. She should be getting ready for the breakout tournament. So we hear that Roxanne is going to be in the breakout tournament, which is surprising because she's already in a storyline with Toxic Attraction and potentially in a position to get a future women's championship match. So maybe she's either going to be getting Toxic Attraction getting in her way in the tournament, or she's obviously potentially earmarked for the finals. One of the two. We then had a segment with Briggs and Jensen where they're backstage and they're getting Jensen's hand looked at from after he was attacked last week. We find out that his right hand is much stronger than his left hand. Find out that's what helped save him. So instead of him having a 10 to 12 week injury, it's only going to be 6 to 8. And the doctor asks him, is there any reason why you think this hand is stronger than the other? And the two guys are looking around. There's an obvious joke to make here. And then the doctor says, are you right-handed? And they instantly jump on the opportunity to not have to make the joke with having made the joke. Very interesting stuff. Kind of cute, kind of juvenile, but it works for the gimmick that they're telling. And then we go ahead and get the Creeds defeating the Viking Raiders after Roderick Strong interferes on their behalf with an amazing drive-by high knee. Really good match. Really enjoyed this. The Creeds seem to excel when they're in these matches where it's hard hitting and they're able to really go at it with teams. And I'm very excited to see this was another case of that. The Creeds were not happy when on the video screen they see that Roderick Strong interfered, and it leads to an argument between the three of them, with Roderick saying it doesn't matter how we won, we just won. That's all that matters. The Creeds are like, no, we want to prove ourselves. We don't want to win because of you. So it's more dissension in the ranks of the Diamond Mine. I'd be excited if I saw Ivy Nile when this all comes to blows. I don't want to see the Creeds punch Roderick Strong down. I want to see Ivy Nile do it. I really think she's earned it. We then had Legado del Fantasmo kidnapping AJ Galante. This was a fun little finishing piece to that Santos Escobar stuff that I didn't think we needed tonight. But Santos Escobar is standing by AJ Galante's car as Tony D'Angelo drops him off in his car before leaving for the night. Santos says that he thinks that AJ is very talented and smart, and that he knows that it'll be important to Tony D'Angelo, and if he were to end up missing, something like that would happen, Tony would go out of his way. And so he goes ahead and kidnaps him. Great storytelling, great continuation of the feud. Really excited to see what happens next. We then got an Alba Fire promo. And again, I'm excited to see what happens with this Alba Fire name. A lot of people aren't thrilled with it. I kind of like it. We get a rundown of some of the stuff to expect next week. We are going to see Roxanne Perez and Wendy Chu take on Toxic Attraction. We're going to see the beginning of the women's breakout tournament, so I'm assuming we'll get two matches out of that. So lots of good stuff to look forward to. After the show, we found out that the eighth name for the women's breakout tournament is going to be Nikita Lyons. That's my pick to win this. I think Nikita Lyons has pretty much got her ticket cashed if they decide to go that way with this. I think it'd be fun to have her have a contract that she can cash in whatever. But with people like Bianca Cerelli and Roxanne Perez and Kiana James and things like that, all kinds of storyline potential here and all kinds of room for something to happen. Main event again was Bron Breakker defeating Joe Gacy. It was a pretty good match. Nothing super impressive, nothing super great, just a really good quality match. After the match, Bron Breakker has his back turned and he's holding up his championship, and two black hooded figures stand on the end of the apron. And the show comes up with a little bug in the corner, and I'm like, cool, they're going to pull a Ciampa. Where Ciampa goes ahead and attacks Johnny Gargano as the show was ready to go off the air. And then the show went off the air. Not really fond of this. They have posted a backstage.com exclusive showing the aftermath of what happens. And if you want to go ahead and find that, go to the NXT socials and you can go ahead and find that. This is a really fun show. Spring Breakin', well, a silly name, really delivered on a lot of the things that they did. All kinds of great storytelling that NXT 2.0 especially has been really known for, with making sure that they're telling stories and all of these characters have something going on. I really enjoyed it. I'm very excited for this. You can catch me on my Twitter at edfries12584. You can catch me on Love Wrestling CA, where I broadcast an NXT show every Tuesday night after NXT. So you can go ahead and catch me there. And again, you can catch me here every week reviewing NXT for you guys for RingScoops. So have a great night. Goodbye.